My name is Mark Depew. I'm a volunteer for the Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library, and we've been doing a series of interviews with people who have stories to tell about Illinois agriculture, and we're here today with Phil Nelson. Do you prefer Phil or Philip?
Philip.
Philip. Okay, sorry about that. Philip, I'm going to throw a curveball at you to start with. How would you define yourself?
Well, looking at my life in general, I've always been planted in agriculture. We have in our family six of us that are all still, implanted into some form of agriculture. I'm a fourth generation farmer, as well as my wife is a fourth generation farmer.
Okay, now what wasn't said there, and this is revealing to me, and the reason I asked the question, you're also currently the president of the Illinois Farm Bureau, is that correct?
That is correct. I've served that position, just completed my fifth year, and also served 4 years as vice president of this organization before ascending into that position, and 7 years as the county Farm Bureau president. So I've spent a number of years in the organization before I got to where I am today.
Okay. But before you got here, you're a farmer, and after you leave here, you're a farmer. Is that right?
That is correct. It's pretty much in my blood, and never have really strayed very far from that. And I think what's appealing is this organization works with farmers across this state, and I think everybody sees the love that we have for the industry as well as the organization.
Okay. What we're going to do here, we're going to spend the first couple hours talking about your life as a farmer, and then later on we'll get into much more detail about the Illinois Farm Bureau, a little bit of background, how it's organized, how it operates, and all of the myriad of things then that you as the president get involved with because of that affiliation. But let's start at the beginning and tell us when and where you were born.
Well, I was born actually in Lake Charles, Louisiana. My dad was an Air Force staff sergeant. So I really started out as a Cajun in Louisiana. First couple of years of my life, that's where I was basically raised.
And you're born what date?
June 12th, 1957.
Okay.
And from there, after Dad got out of the Air Force, he went back to farming with his dad, Leonard Nelson. And my dad was Stanley Nelson. And
did he retire from the Air Force?
He spent 4 years in the Air Force, and then went back home to farm with his father, so kind of a father-son relationship, much like I had when I farmed with my dad. They basically grew up on a dairy farm in the northern part of LaSalle County, and at that time, very diversified. Not only did we have dairy cattle, we had chickens, we grew corn, soybeans, oats, hay, as the major cash crops. But at an early age, I got involved in farming. I think I was 4 years old when we all fought over riding the lawnmower, mowing the grass. But at age six, I learned how to drive a tractor for the first time, pulling a hay fork back and forth, pulling hay up into a barn.
Okay. There's a couple pictures that are behind you here. Is that the main picture? Is that your farm today?
Yes, it is. And if you look back at these other pictures, this was the same farm many years ago when my grandfather had it.
Do you know how the family got to that piece of land in the first place? Three, four generations back?
Well, four generations ago, our ancestors came from Norway, around Oslo, Norway. We happened to live in the oldest Norwegian settlement in the United States of America. We live about 6 miles from Norway. We also attend the oldest Norwegian Lutheran church in all of the United States of America, about 169 years and counting.
Do you know roughly when the family got there? What year?
I do not know that. I would have to look that up.
Mid-1800s, perhaps?
Yes. Well, our house that I live in is at the turn of the century. Early 1900s or late 1800s is when that house was built.
And the family had already been there for quite a while.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
But we've remodeled the house. As you can see, at the various picture levels, remodeled it, added on, but really the main part of the house is pretty much the same as it was when it was built.
So there's a lot of stories that are connected with that house.
Actually, probably the most interesting one that my wife doesn't like people to know, it was one of the largest farmhouses in the particular area, and a lot of funerals were held in this house because it had a bay window where the casket would be put for the various neighbors to come and pay their last respects to people. Hmm. And the porch had an unusually wide door so they could move the caskets in and out. So that's a little bit of nostalgia that goes with our house, but back in that day, it was one of the largest farmsteads in the particular area.
Did you have some brothers or sisters growing up?
Yes, I have two brothers. As I said before, all of us are still kind of rooted in agriculture. My older brother works for Farm Credit Services in Bloomington. His name is Narlin, and he's been there about 28 years. I have a younger brother, Daryl, who works in the agriculture lending business for Yorkville National Bank. I have three sisters, the oldest of which works for the DeKalb County Farm Bureau. She's married to a farmer, and they farm outside of Waterman in DeKalb County. My middle sister is married to a farmer in the Springfield area, and they have three boys, and they farm there. And my youngest sister lives in Janesville, Wisconsin, and her husband sells fertilizer for an ag industry. So none of us have really left the farm, and on my wife's side, they're pretty much all involved in agriculture as well, and her dad still farms.
What was the size? You talked a little bit about the farm, but what was the size of the farm you grew up on?
Well, you know, my younger years, we were farming about 480 acres. Today, we're about 1,800 acres. So the size of the farm has grown. Mm-hmm. It really has changed. I mean, we have a cattle feedlot operation instead of the dairy that we once had. It's on the same place. We've grown the hog operation where we used to be farrow to finish, which means everything from birth to market. Now we basically buy weanling pigs at about 15 days of age and finish those hogs. My son and daughter are in 4-H, and they have started a small beef operation for their project. And then we also raise corn, soybeans, and wheat.
Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit about the chores that you had when you were growing up.
Well, it's very different from today. When we were kids growing up on a dairy farm, and back in those days, basically, there wasn't much additional labor that was hired. And with six kids in the family, my sisters were the milkmaids in the dairy operation. They literally would milk the cows. I spent much of my time doing the grinding, the hauling of the manure, as well as, you know, helping out in the milking and feeding the calves. But we were grown up and taught at an early age that you had to pull your fair share of the load. So we basically did much of the calf chore and some of the milking before we'd even be able to go to school in the morning. So we were very involved.
Tell me your routine then. When did you get up in the morning and what did you do before you got on that school bus or got to school?
Well, we'd get up about 5 o'clock every morning and go out, get things going, and if chores weren't quite finished, Dad and Mom would finish them, but then go back in the house, take a shower, and be on a school bus by 7:30, 7:45.
Where'd you go to school?
The grade school, we went to Melton Pope Grade School, which is a rural school district, a feeder school district. It fed four high schools, very small in nature by today's standards, but a couple hundred kids. And then from there, we went to Newark High School as a family.
Now, you mentioned your church before. Tell us a little bit more about that church, because I think that's important to the family story.
Well, it's got an interesting past. From the standpoint, it's a rural church that had the roots from the ancestors coming from Norway that started this small little congregation. But what's really appealing, I've served on the church council for about a dozen years, and now my wife has been there for about the same. And we've always had just strong rural roots in that particular church. 12 years ago, We hired a pastor. I happened to be on the call committee. And we've been very fortunate and blessed by his preaching, because we were going from an average Sunday of 75 to 90 people to now, or before we built the new church 2 years ago, we were having Sunday attendance close to 200. And now we built a new church that would seat 350 to 400 people. And we are full to capacity at this point in time 2 years later. I guess we didn't project that we were going to grow to that type or that magnitude that quickly. So we've been very blessed. But I think the difference was, back at the old church, all of us were farmers for the most part. But given the people that are moving out from the cities to the farmettes or the small little communities that we draw from in our church, basically those are the people that are attending our church. We still have the rural roots that we started from, but that hasn't changed, and I think a lot of it has to do with the pastor that is very appealing to a number of people in the area.
Was there a time where the church services were in Norwegian?
Yes, they were. As a matter of fact, as kids, the four oldest in our family, on two different Christmas services, we sang a song in Norwegian that was part of the Christmas program. So yes, our heritage is strongly rooted in the Norwegian ancestry.
Well, that would mean even mid to late 60s, early 70s, they're still singing songs in Norwegian there.
That is true, and we still have our Christmas dinners still include a number of Norwegian favorites as it relates to food. You still see the lutefisk and lefse that a lot of the older members of the church are very fond of.
Do you like lutefisk?
I wouldn't say that I'm a strong believer in lutefisk, but the lefse part of it, yeah. Yes, we very much do.
For those who don't know about lutefisk, maybe just a very quick definition or description of what it is.
Well, it depends on what your appetite is for fish, because it's basically got a fish base to it, and you've got to acquire the taste.
But it's cured in lye?
Yes, and that's why I say you have to acquire the taste.
Okay.
It never really resonated with me, let's put it that way.
What's the affiliation of the church now?
We are a member of the American Free Lutheran Churches. We made kind of a switch when the ELC and the ALC combined back a few years ago, and there's a number of churches in our particular area that are a part of the American Free Lutheran Churches.
Okay. What else kept you busy when you were growing up?
Well, our family was very involved in 4-H and FFA. As a matter of fact, I think every one of us had that in our blood, whether it was the competition, whether it was what 4-H and FFA had to offer. But I think we're a unique family, because out of the six of us, five of us were state FFA officers. We have more blue and gold jackets in our closet than you can imagine. And I think probably as part of that was the public speaking that we learned through the organization, the traveling, getting to meet other people across this state and across this country, made that organization fairly unique. And as a result of that, my mom and dad were honored back in 1991 at the National FFA Convention with the Honorary American Farmer degree at the time, for the fact they were the first husband and wife that had five state FFA officers.
Wow. Tell us a little bit about what's different between 4-H and FFA.
Well, they're two very good organizations that really, I think, help today's youth to try to not only motivate them, but to kind of point them in a direction they may want to look at in their career path. But 4-H, I think, is more broad-based than the FFA organization at a younger age. But when you get to high school, I think there's a clear distinction. FFA concentrates more on your career development path than 4-H does. But I think the two complement each other. And I hope that our son and daughter get as much out of the organization as what we did as kids going through it.
Were state fairs, county fairs, those kinds of things important? Was that part of it?
That was our vacation time in the Nelson household. at being on a dairy farm, as you know, there are no days off. I mean, it's 365 days a year, two times a day to get the cows in, milk the cows. So we really never got away from it. But our vacation time that we really enjoyed as kids was lugging around 1,500-pound black and white Holstein cattle to the county fair, the state fair, sandwich fair. Those were the main fairs that we exhibited at during the course of the year.
What was the last fair?
Sandwich at DeKalb County, probably the largest county fair in the state of Illinois. And what makes it unique is it has that old-time look to it as a county fair.
What were some of the other advantages going to the fairs? Getting to meet some of the other kids, perhaps?
Yeah, and you know, one of the things that I remember back in the 80s when I was in, finishing up my FFA career, we were showing at the Illinois State Fair with then Ag Secretary Jack Block, head President Ronald Reagan at the Illinois State Fair, and we were showing a particular class of Holstein heifers, and the President of the United States walked into the ring and went down the row with about a dozen of us that were exhibiting our animals, and came up to us, talked to us, very personable gentleman, and later got to know the Secretary of Ag, Jack Block, and myself are pretty good friends, and we converse back and forth. But it goes back to a state fair in the 80s when we first met.
You wouldn't happen to have a picture of you and the president, would you?
I don't know if I have one, actually, because we were, so we didn't know it was going to happen the way that it was. My mom, we were all getting ready for the next class of Holstein heifers, mm-hmm. but it was quite an impression that all of us in our family had when the President of the United States came up and talked to us.
I can't imagine anything else than that kind of reaction to that. I think I know the answer to this, but when you got into high school, what were your career aspirations?
Well, I always had one thing on my mind, even going back to when I first ran that John Deere tractor pulling the hay up into the mow, and that's what I wanted to do, is be a farmer. I've lived and breathed it. There's something about farming from the standpoint you're independent, you can make your own decisions, but it's a great place to raise a family, where you work together every day. Sometimes you yell at each other every day, but I think everybody's their own boss. And I always had that in mind, and when I got to high school, I think it just reinforced that, because being involved in the FFA, I had a great ag teacher, Richard Dunn, who really pushed me on a number of fronts, from public speaking. And I remember the first time that there was an opening for an extemporaneous public speaking contest, and he said, you know, Philip, you need to go to that. And I found out then that I needed to work at my speaking skills, because I placed 8 out of 9 contestants that particular night. But I had a great mentor and an ag teacher who believed in me, pushed me. 4 years later, I was the star farmer of Illinois over everybody. He pushed me into a state FFA office. I obtained my American Farmer degree following my dad's footsteps, who really grew up in FFA as well, and kind of an interesting story there. When my dad got his American Farmer degree, which at that time was the highest degree the national organization could offer, Dad and his ag teacher went to Kansas City, Missouri to get that award, and the ag teacher decided to take a sidebar trip the morning that he was to receive that award, and went to Harry Truman's house. And they were parked outside. My dad was taking a picture, or the ag teacher was taking a picture of my dad standing outside of Harry Truman's house. And within a couple minutes, the president walked out and invited my dad and the ag teacher in for breakfast. And what's interesting is you fast forward that to 1991, when Dad and Mom went back to get their honorary degree. They went to the same house where Dad went as an FFA officer, and the security guard and my dad talked, and he could not believe that the president would come out and invite him in for a breakfast. But you got to keep in mind, the security detail back in those days was far different than it is today. But Dad never forgot that as long as he lived.
And the Truman home is rather unimpressive looking place. That always amazes me.
It's a very ordinary house. You would not even think that a president of the United States would have lived there.
Yeah. The American Farmer degree, can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Well, less than 1% of all of the FFA members that are part of the organization obtain that degree. There's certain thresholds that you have to obtain as it relates to projects that you carry on during the course of your FFA career. It's judged at the state level, and so many state farmers, which you have to be an American farmer, now it's an American FFA degree, and then that culmination is recognized and awarded at the national convention. I think that what's interesting is five of the six of us in our family all got the American FFA degree. The only exception being my oldest sister, and this dates me, but girls were not allowed in FFA till she was a senior in high school. And that was really the main reason that she never really got involved in FFA. But my oldest sister, Noreen, was the first female officer in the FFA in Illinois. And my youngest sister followed in her footsteps as state reporter as well.
You mentioned the importance of this one teacher, Richard Dunn, as being a mentor for you. Can you name anybody else who was especially important influence on your life at that time?
Well, back at that time, actually my dad always pushed every one of us to try to do better. And my mom was right there, and they were a great tag team. And they always tried to get us involved in things, whether it was at the 4-H level when we first started, the FFA level, get involved in our church. I think they all instilled in us some strong moral foundation principles that all of us have lived our lives by. Mm-hmm. And I think it speaks well of our family based on what they did at a very early age in instilling that in us.
What was your dad's advice as you got into your senior year in high school?
Well, Dad was never afraid to push us to try things different, but he'd also let us make mistakes. And I still remember the first time he turned me loose plowing a particular cornstalk field. He rode with me one round, and he said, "I think you got the hang of it, go ahead." And the next round, I turned the plow, and I did not realize the plow wheel hooked into the fence. And I looked back, and it was pulling the fence across the field as we were going across. And Dad was watching the whole thing, and he said, "I hope you've learned a valuable lesson. Now go back and fix the fence." And he would do that in all of us, whether it was milking cows, showing cattle, putting up hay or corn silage. And all of us really were taught a number of the farm chores at a very early age. And I think all of us just accepted the fact that we all had hard work ethics in growing up on a dairy farm and being part of a farming operation.
Mm-hmm. Was there any discussion about whether or not you needed to go on to get a college degree?
Actually, of all six of us, I'm the only one that did not finish the four-year degree. My brothers and sisters all graduated from the University of Illinois in ag. And I was kind of the lone person that didn't. And part of that was due to the fact when I graduated from Joliet Junior College, I was accepted at the University of Illinois and a couple other colleges for judging purposes, livestock judging. My dad became very ill and had kidney failure. And he really couldn't carry on the duties of running our farm. Our farm had expanded at that time. So I had a very difficult decision to make in basically keeping the farming operation going with my mom or finishing my 4 years. And I decided to take a pass at that time, saying that I could go back and finish it. Little did I know that I'd get involved to the magnitude that I did in the Soybean Association and then the Farm Bureau, that the career path would take me in a place where I did not get back to finish that four-year degree. But I think in this job that I'm in today, it's a learning experience every day. And I've told that to our son and our daughter, that, you know, just because I didn't finish doesn't mean that they won't need that type of degree in the future to be a part of, you know, a farming operation or whatever they want to do.
You've got six of you all together, if I got my math right. Why was it you who ended up working the family farm?
You know, it was kind of interesting how it shook out, because I was probably the one person in our family who probably loved the livestock as well as the grain. And I had brothers or sisters that they just wanted to be a grain farmer, and we were always strongly rooted in the livestock area. And as my sisters got older and went away to college and fell in love with farmers or whatever, they still are very much involved in farming. But my older brother, who is still very involved with us today, matter of fact, I own a farm in partnership with him, he still comes back in the spring and the fall for 2 or 3 weeks of his vacation time away from his job to run tractors and equipment, but he doesn't really care for the livestock part of it. So that's probably what pulled me back more than anything, is I love both. And at the time, I was expanding our operation with hogs and with beef cattle, which kind of complemented what we were doing on the dairy side.
Tell us a little bit about that transition from your father in the lead in running the daily operation and making the important decisions, and the transition to where you are in the lead, and how the farm evolved during that time as well.
Well, I was very fortunate, because I've seen a lot of father-son operations across this state where the father still is in charge when he might be 80 years old and the son's 60. My dad let loose of the reins when his health failed, and literally said, you know, Philip, you're in charge.
What year would that have been?
It would have been in the 70s. I was right out of junior college. Mm-hmm. I had a small operation of my own. I had a couple farms that I was farming. We combined what I was doing with what he was doing. And really, it was my mother and myself that managed the operation, because his health was failing. He was on dialysis, went through kidney failure. He eventually did get a kidney transplant after my mom had passed away, but he was not really in a situation that he could go back into farming. So he pretty much relied on me as the son that came back to farm to run the farm and make those decisions. So it was a good relationship, but, you know, part of it was tempered by the fact that his health was failing.
Were you making some decisions to change the direction that the farm was going?
Well, when Dad's health failed and my last sister went off to college, we did have to make the decision, my mom and myself, to eliminate the dairy operation, because we didn't have the labor that was necessary. That was a big change. And then we went to feeding beef cattle in the same particular setup that we were used to with the dairy operation. In the meantime, I was expanding the hog operation. We picked up some additional acreage to farm. So we were growing the operation all at the same time that we were making that transition.
How about purchasing additional land?
Well, I was fortunate not to buy land right when I got out of college in the late 70s, early 80s, because at that time, land was on an inflationary spiral upward. And unfortunately, just like what we've went through this year with the volatility in the commodity prices, the land prices peaked, and a guy by the name of Paul Volcker, who was the head of the Federal Reserve, thought we had too much inflation, and deflation started, and farmers that bought land at the high of the market really went through quite the turmoil in the 80s just to hang on to what they had. So in answer to your question, I really purchased my first piece of farmland almost at the low of the marketplace when things were looking pretty bleak in the early 80s.
Okay. Was that because you were very prescient and could figure out that that's the best time to buy, or did you get lucky?
Well, my grandfather always told me, you'll never cash flow farmland. Even at the low or the high of the market, you've just got to have enough diversity in your portfolio. And I've always been diversified in our farming operation. And by that, I mean we didn't count on corn and soybeans, you know, in its entirety or totality, or we didn't count on the dairy or the beef cattle or the hogs. So you have good and bad years with all of those particular commodities, and I think that's what pulls you through the lean years.
But by making that decision, taking that approach, you're kind of going against the grain of the direction that other farmers were taking, weren't you?
At that particular time, yes. And that particular piece of property I still own today, and it's the cheapest ground that I bought. But it was still a big decision when everybody was painting such a bleak picture about what was going on in production agriculture. At that time, farmers were being forced out because they couldn't make their payments. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a pretty big step to take, but there's always risks that are involved in farming, and whether it's that or we look just at the volatility in the marketplace.
You're a bachelor during these early years as a farmer, is that correct?
That is true.
Well, tell us when you met your wife.
Well, I was 35 years old. I was president of the local school board. I was fixed up on a blind date by a fellow school board member who farmed and said, there's this teacher at Seneca High School you really ought to meet. She's a farm gal. Her dad farms down in the St. Louis area. So we were set up at a school board function where three of our school districts got together for a Christmas dinner every year. And she happened to be at that particular meeting, and that's the first time that I met her, and we dated for about 4 years before we got married.
You got married what year?
In 1995.
And her name?
Carmen.
What was her maiden name?
Carmen Bassett. Her dad is a third generation farmer in the Greenville area in Bond County. Very different types of farming operations. He has a small cow-calf herd and grows corn, soybeans, and wheat. So he has livestock as well, but he still farms today and still has that type of diversification. So my wife actually was one of the few unique individuals as a woman that really was very involved in the farming operation when she went through college and her career path.
But you mentioned you were 35 before you got married.
That's correct.
What took up your time, not that farming all of this land and being very aggressive in what you're doing with the farm wasn't a full-time job, but I think there were some other things going on in your life as well, weren't there?
Well, I was very involved in the community. As I said earlier, I was on the church council. I spent 12 years on our local school board at Melton Pope. Basically, I served 11 of those years as president of the school board. I was very involved in the Young Farmers Organization of Illinois Farm Bureau, as well as the soybean organization. So my platter was pretty much filled with a number of community activities. And at the same time, I did quite a bit of banquet speaking, traveling around the state and the country, giving annual meeting speeches.
What were the subjects of the speeches?
Well, they changed from time to time. A lot of it challenging people to think outside of the box, the way agriculture was changing. And those were some difficult years. Back in the 80s, as an example, there were a lot of people that were forced out of farming. Credit was tight. That was very much a different type of speech to annual meetings as it was in the 90s when, there were some pretty good times in agriculture. So, and it all depended on the audience, whether it was an annual meeting, whether it was an FFA annual meeting, an elevator appreciation dinner. You tailor it to the people that you're speaking to.
But I think we're missing something in this story here, Philip, because why you versus the thousands of others out there who are also farming?
Well, I've always had, the love to farm, and I've always had the ability and I think a God-given talent to speak up for agriculture and to be involved in trying to represent people and trying to make the industry a better one.
Did those opportunities to speak and to be a leader come from your involvement with the Illinois Farm Bureau, or is it just the diversity of things that you're involved in?
Actually, I think it was a compilation of a number of things. I think my speaking skills were developed a little bit when I was in the FFA organization. I got involved in the ALLOT program of Illinois Farm Bureau. That's the Ag Leaders of Tomorrow. That was kind of a launching pad. I happened to be in the very first Illinois Ag Leadership Program. that was funded by the Kellogg Foundation, and that program still exists today. I was the young kid in the class. That was basically a group of people from age 25 to 42. And that really probably opened my eyes, because that was the first time that I traveled abroad. At that time, we went to Europe and met with a number of ministers of agriculture. We studied the common agriculture policy of the European Economic Community. And at the same time, we were going through a lot of turmoil back here in this country as we were trying to write a farm bill. So I think it's all those experiences that really melted inside me that became who I am today, for the experiences that I was fortunate to be a part of early on.
The travel overseas, was that because of the affiliation with a lot?
That was because of the Illinois Ag Leadership Program. That was a 2-year study group. The first year you honed in on domestic issues, the second year international issues. As a matter of fact, on the domestic front, our class traveled to Washington, D.C. and had a face-to-face meeting with Paul Volcker, chairman of the Federal Reserve. And as I said before, you know, it was interesting because he made that, you know, that decision to tighten the belt from an inflationary perspective and cause deflation in agriculture, which deflated a lot of the asset values of farmers.
So that's the pain involved with the whole, his decision.
That's correct.
But he was the one who was credited with getting the American economy out of that nasty stagflation cycle that was in at the time.
And he did, but it did have an adverse effect on the agriculture industry.
Okay. I still don't know that I understand part of the travels and your relationships and what was going on at that time. Who was paying the bills for that travel? Was that a state? Actually, the state picked up?
Actually, part of the Ag Leadership Program was a funding grant by the Kellogg Foundation that provided that.
Okay.
But we were responsible of traveling to and from the seminars in state. They picked up the travel at the domestic level, where we traveled to Washington, and the 2.5 weeks of international travel that we had.
What struck you when you went overseas and saw how others were doing it?
Well, I think probably my biggest impression were the doors that were open being a part of this trip. Because at that time, you know, there was a lot of, I think, finger pointing at the European Economic Community because of their heavy subsidization of farmers versus what we have said all along as an organization, and me personally as an individual: give me the ability to produce and level the playing field, and we think we can compete with anybody. We saw firsthand what those subsidies did to small farmers in Europe that farmed the equivalent of 90 or 100 acres versus at that time 500 or 600 acres back in this country, and the prices that they were receiving really caught our eye. I mean, soybeans at that time, and this was back in the early 80s, were selling between $13 and $14 a bushel. Back here, they were $6 or $7 a bushel. So there was a huge disparity in the price structure. And I think it also caught my eye of what, you know, really free enterprise is all about. You could see from our perspective in this country, our ability to tackle and adapt technology, where Europe was pretty much stagnated. You know, they had a quota system that they could only produce so much, and once they hit that quota, there was really a discouragement of not going any further. Where in this country, we always try to improve ourselves from an efficiency standpoint by producing more and more on a per acre or a per head basis. You didn't see that in Europe at that time.
Mm-hmm. Well, this leads into a myriad of different kind of questions and different approaches we can take. Let me start with this one. A lot of the criticism that's continuing on to this day, if you look back in the history of what's happened in American agriculture, is that the demise of the family farm and growth towards the corporate farm. But your discussion about the difference between Europe's model and our model would suggest that, to a certain extent, you're okay with that?
Well, I think that, you know, we've changed the structure of farming operations over time. And I still consider ours a very much a family-run operation. And I can see it in this organization. That family-run operation, I can go to an example in Southern Illinois where a family farms 18,000 acres and there's 12 families, all the same family that live off of that operation. And they employ nobody outside of the family. That's still a family-run operation, even though it's much larger than what people typically think of a farm. Our farm is not large by any stretch of the imagination today, by today's standards. So I think the structure of farming has changed over time. I think one of the reasons that operations have gotten larger mainly is due to the fact of the efficiency. I think technology has driven part of that. And I think the other thing that you really look at when you start looking at the investments that you make in combines and tractors and planters and sprayers, you have to spread those over more acres to justify your purchasing power and your overhead in a particular operation. I mean, the days are gone where you could afford a combine and a tractor in a new one or a newer one on 160 or 240 acres. And I think technology has driven a lot of that. Mm-hmm. And the fact is, on a per acre or per bushel basis, we've got to ratchet down that screw to the point that you have to have that efficiency to make money.
And what differentiated our model here in the United States versus that model in Europe, where the average farm was dramatically smaller?
Well, I think the whole capitalism of the production agriculture gives somebody the ability to compete, gives somebody the ability to make their own decisions, and don't let the government tell you what to do. In the common agriculture policy, and now with the European Union expanding to 26 member countries, basically, they still have that stigma above their head. They're breaking out of it a little bit. They're starting to adapt to biotechnology, but at a much slower pace than what we have done in this country.
And the difference, you think, is the amount of government involvement or the amount of government subsidies they have in Europe versus here?
I still think it exists today in a little bit different form. It may not be on the per hectare basis or the per bushel basis that it was back in the early 80s. That's diminished because they still have a pot of money, but it's instead of 13 member countries, it's distributed over 26. But I think the thing that is different is they still have somewhat government intervention that determines the quotas that they raise on a per hectare basis or a per animal basis, where we don't have that. We have said in this country, and I think we've gravitated towards change in our farm bills, going back to the first farm bill to the one that we're operating under today, is we have allowed the farmer to make those decisions. And as we went to the freedom to farm back in the 90s in that farm bill, I think we tried to decouple what we have looked at as it relates to set-asides and direct payments to farmers to say, let the marketplace decide and dictate to you as a producer whether you want to plant more acres of corn or more acres of beans this next year based on what the market is signaling, mm-hmm. not what a government farm program is dictating.
Well, that was the other major direction that I did want to go with this, and that's the role of subsidies and the role that government has to play in their policies in this country as well. Because if I'm hearing you right, you're saying that, this might be the wrong word, but the government was in Europe tended to be much more intrusive or involved in dictating management decisions to European farmers than here traditionally.
Well, dollars drove that in Europe. When you started looking at $13 a bushel soybeans for X amount of bushel, and if you went over that quota, that $13 became $6. So there were thresholds that really dictated what producers would produce in Europe.
Are you saying that the government would guarantee $13 a bushel for soybeans, but only if you produced
raised X amount? That's correct. It was a quota system where we've never went that route. And I will tell you, if you look over history of farm programs, some things in our particular farm policy, looking back on it, you know, did not work. Set-asides is an example to take acres out of production. Back in the 70s and 80s, we had set-asides for corn and soybeans. Corn, for the most part, it was feed grains. We would have those to try to limit production, to try to raise prices so you would not receive government payments. The fallacy in that thought process was we were going into a global economy. And what happened is we would cut back our corn production here, but Europe or South America, Argentina specifically, would increase their corn acres. So really, it didn't move the needle on commodity prices like people thought it would.
Wasn't part of the problem also that while you're setting aside acres, you're still increasing the productivity on the acres that are still in production?
That was also a part of it. You'd always put your worst acres into set-aside. But I think the fallacy of the whole set-aside movement was just look at what South America did during that period of time that we were set-aside acres to try to prop up the prices. What they did is basically cleared rainforest to bring more acres into production. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we learned from our past mistakes, and I don't think set-asides work when you're in a global economy such as we are.
The set-aside program, was that direct payments to farmers if they set aside a certain percentage or
yes.
number of acres?
Yes.
Do you recall what the numbers were on that?
Oh, I'd have to go back and look some of that up. But it was, you got to keep in mind, price of corn at that time was $1.50 to $2 a bushel. So if it were going to make a big difference to your bottom line, for the most part, everybody coming out of the 80s, when we instituted those set-asides, you know, to protect yourself and give you a floor to not only put crops under loan, to sell crops, that sort of thing. The bankers, coming through that whole financial crisis that we did in the 80s, pretty much required farmers to be a part of the government program to have that type of safety net. Mm-hmm. Now, contrast that back in the 80s when things were not going the right way in production agriculture from a profitability standpoint, contrast that with today where farmers have the ability to decide what crops to grow. They have much more flexibility in trying to determine their particular futures based on the market signals that are being given, not the signals that a farm program was set up.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know that the ultimate challenge in American agriculture has always been, well, farmers are so darn good at what they do, they can always produce a lot more than the market seems to be able to bear. And that was the reason for all of these things that we've been discussing, the set-aside and subsidies. How has that dynamic changed over the last 20, 30 years, or has it?
I think the biggest dynamic has changed has been the global environment that we're in. We're now seeing, you know, based on what's going on in China or Asia and what their buying habits are, as you see some of these developing countries or underdeveloped countries have come into the marketplace for our commodities. And it isn't just corn, soybeans. It's meat products. And being a livestock producer, you know, we certainly have helped to try to develop those markets. But I think, you know, this last year, in the year 2008, I think really you have witnessed kind of a whole transformation in agriculture, because it used to be just that we were produced for a particular market. Now we, as farmers, are producing not only for food, fuel, and feed. And we see that whole dichotomy in the minds of farmers. You know, should I plant this particular trait in my farming operation for the local ethanol plant, which will yield more gallons of ethanol than a traditional hybrid? Or should I plant this particular hybrid that will have more protein in it for a hog farmer down the road and I'll get a premium for that? Or do I grow pharmaceutical crops? I mean, the whole difference between going back to the 80s and early 90s to where we're at today is I think now farmers are becoming more astute marketers in looking at what type of products that they want to grow for the marketplace.
I want you to take you back to your early years in farming, and I don't know if I'm going to get these dates right, but my guess is about the time you got into farming is also about the time that the United States started to sell to Russia, to the Soviet Union. Do you recall what impact that had at the time?
I was in high school, at Newark High School, and I remember coming home one night after school, and Dad and Mom were just euphoric. Beans had just hit $12 a bushel, soybeans, and we'd never seen that type of plateau. I also remember, as at that time, Earl Butz, Secretary of Agriculture, certainly one of my mentors as a secretary is concerned, because Earl really stood up, or Secretary Butz really stood up for farmers' interests. And what he said back in the 70s is, we've got the ability to produce fence row to fence row in this country, because through the way that farmers think in this country, they can take technology from the research laboratory and apply it into the field probably as fast as any other farmer on the face of this earth. Having said that, your comment that we always seem to overproduce, and I think part of the reason for that is that adaption of technology occurs first here in this country, and the fastest. And we sometimes have the most bang for the buck to get that technology up and running. But having said that, going back to when the Russians came knocking at the door, and Earl Butz made the comment at that time, I would rather be trading food than bullets, it meant a lot of sense. And I think really that was what transformed agriculture to where it is today. Going back to those mid-70s, when we decided to say, we got to change our stance on trading with the world. And whether it's Russia, whether it's China today, you know, it's happening. Unfortunately, one of the biggest challenges that we face today is tearing down some of the trade barriers that these developing countries or developed countries are putting in place to not allow trade to flow both ways.
On the counter side of that, I think there was a time when there was a grain embargo.
Well, that's where I was going to go for. I remember my mom and dad's faces with the enthusiasm and that euphoric look, but I also remember when Jimmy Carter slammed the door shut on all of that and the prices came tumbling down. And that was a sad moment in time, because we felt agriculture was being singled out, you know, and with that singling out, that also sent the signal to South America to produce, because we were still, or they were still clearing lands down there. At the same time, we shut off trade based on what the president thought at that time needed to happen to embargo products going in there.
Did you know, or your parents know, anybody who was impacted so much at that time that they got driven out of farming?
I don't recall the fact of somebody getting that got driven out of farming, but it really tightened the screws down in the marketplace, because we went from this euphoria that we were seeing to pulling things back down to the pre-Russian deals that Secretary Butz pushed forward.
Mm-hmm. Next question then. You've spent your entire life being involved in a variety of different organizations, and it seems to me that early in your life you made the decision to become very closely affiliated with the Illinois Farm Bureau. And I'm framing the question this way: why the Illinois Farm Bureau and not the Farm Union or other organizations you could have selected?
Well, I should show you that we have a long, rich tradition in our family in Farm Bureau on both sides. Mm-hmm. My wife's parents, grandparents, were leaders in the Bond County Farm Bureau system. But I really followed my grandfather and father's footsteps. My dad actually was on the LaSalle County Farm Bureau Board at the time when I was involved in these other organizations, and he said, you know, I need to step down, you need to go on. But a friend of ours, and we had two directors from each particular region of LaSalle County on the Farm Bureau Board, his best friend stepped down, and Dad said, I think you ought to get involved in this. And he pushed me on, and I didn't think that it would turn out this way, but 1 year after I got on that board, I was serving as president of the local county Farm Bureau. So it goes back to my grandfather, Leonard, and then my dad, Stanley, who served on that board of directors long before I came around.
Well, part of the question was, based on these different farm organizations taking different views towards important things like governmental farm policy. And I wanted to see if you can address that part of the answer.
Well, I think one of the reasons that we're involved in Farm Bureau and not other organizations such as you have alluded to is I think the belief that this organization was founded on. I go back almost 93 years ago in Tazewell County, where a group of farmers got together and said, by collectively working together, we can accomplish more than going it alone. And that's really what founded this organization almost 93 years ago. I believe that same belief has been fast-forwarded to today, where I think the belief that this organization, with all the people collectively working together, can accomplish a lot more than as an individual you can. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that belief has strayed very far from the ancestors that started the organization. I think, philosophically speaking, our organization has always said, you know, we want entrepreneurship to take place in production agriculture. We support that in this organization. I think we also support in this organization to try to grow people to become spokesmen, more articulate spokespeople in the organization representing this industry. So there's a number of really strong foundational beliefs that pulled me into this organization, and partly it was family, but partly it's the philosophy that this organization stands for.
Would it be fair to say then that the Farm Bureau, the Illinois Farm Bureau, tends to generally favor less government involvement, less government subsidies, less government support than Farmers Union or other organizations?
I think that that's a very fair statement, because we've always believed in free trade, fair trade, and more trade. I think, secondly, we've always said, you know, show us a better way to farm, whether that's technology that we use in the particular row crop operations or what we breed in as far as efficiency into our animals that we raise, whether that's beef, pork, dairy. Yes, we believe in that, those strong principles. And, you know, for the most part, I think our organization has not strayed very far from that over the longevity of time.
Okay. We need to take a quick break right now, and I think this is a good place to do that, and we'll pick it up in just a couple minutes.
Okay.
We're back with our second session with Philip Nelson, and we wanted to talk a little bit more about your experiences as a farmer before we got into your experiences with the Illinois Farm Bureau, especially as the president. So take you back to all these many years. You've been involved with farming how many years now? Nah, put you on the spot again.
Boy, 2008 to about 78, so 30 years.
Okay. And you've seen a lot of changes, I would think, during those years. Let's talk about land management practices, especially low-till or no-till.
Well, in the 30 years, I've seen it all. I mean, I can remember back as a kid where my dad was a firm believer in soil conservation. We did no tillage in the fall because he and my grandfather believed you'd lose your precious topsoil to the blowing and drifting of that precious topsoil. So we would do most of our tillage as it related to corn and soybeans in the spring of the year. Now, granted, we weren't farming quite the acres that we do today, but we have much smaller equipment. I mean, a 20-foot disc was a big thing back then. Now we use a 43-foot rig in front of our corn planter today. But we did things very differently when I was, you know, first starting out farming with Dad. I think over that period of time, I think farmers in this state went to a lot of no-till to conserve the topsoil, but even more importantly, reduce the number of trips over the field. The price of diesel fuel has went up substantially, especially this last year, where farmers try to minimize the impact and the usage of diesel fuel in their farming operations by either using bigger equipment or less passes over the field. So that whole transformation in 30 years, we went from, I would think, a very conventional type of an operation to reduced and minimum till and no-till as we see it today.
What's the trade-off?
I think there was once the fallacy to say the less trips that you use, the more compaction you're going to have, and you're not going to see the particular production. But I think there isn't much of a trade-off today. From the standpoint that we've developed hybrids on both the corn and the soybean side as it relates to genetics that I think compensate for the reduced tillage trips. I think we've got harder year seeds today given those genetics, so they can withstand the colder elements that they might be planted into the soil here in this state. So I don't think there are a lot of trade-offs, and I think most farmers feel very comfortable with a minimum or no-till operation today, as opposed to 30 years ago where we still didn't have quite the chemicals to spray to control the weed pressure. We didn't have the technology in the seed that we have today as it relates to withstanding some of the bug pressure, whether that's rootworm or corn borer. So there's been just, I think, the evolution of technology through seed and through chemicals has really changed in the last 30 years quite substantially.
Well, that gets me to a couple of the other areas that I did want to talk to you about, and you've already talked about a little bit, but if you can go into the impact of hybrids, and especially connect that with the growth in production or increase in production.
Well, I think I'd go back and I'll use a realistic comment of what happened in the late 60s, early 70s, and I was fairly young at the time. I remember when we had the blight issue in corn production. There was no technology in place that could compensate for that, and particular hybrids were more susceptible to it than others, and it was devastating from the standpoint.
A little bit more about the blight itself.
Well, basically, it was a fungus that set in on the particular corn plant, and it would have a dramatic impact on yields.
Was it on the ears themselves?
Yes. The ear actually is a combination of both the ear and the leaf. And depending on what strain you would have, it could wipe out your yields 50%. Now, going back 30 years ago, 100 to 120 bushel corn was a good thing. Nothing like today where we are in that 180, 170 range almost on a consistent basis. You look to the future, some people are predicting we're going to be averaging 200 bushel corn in the next 5 years. A decade from now, some are saying we could be as high as 250. And part of that is that transformation of genetics. We now are stacking traits into that particular seed that are resistant to insects. They have traits in there that they're resistant to various forms of chemicals that you apply, which the good part about all of this technology is it's really safer for the environment because it's in the seed where it needs to be to basically have that type of resistance. We apply less pesticides today than we have in time, and I think that will continue.
But anytime you bring up the issue of genetically altered seeds, or there's a debate that goes on around that, is there not?
Well, there has been a debate. I think consumers are getting more comfortable with the new technologies that are going through further scrutiny or more scrutiny today. I happen to be on the very first USDA biotechnology advisory team. And on there, we went through the whole incident of Starlink, where there was a split registration for a particular technology that ended up getting into basically the marketplace. It didn't have any effect on people, but needless to say, we didn't have the channeling in place to protect that. Having said that, now the scrutiny between EPA and FDA and USDA, and you put that whole jurisdiction in place with the National Institute of Health, I think we probably have the toughest set of a regulatory framework for approving technology today that we've ever had.
I'd like to be able to put the Starlink incident that you talked about, if I'm pronouncing that right.
Starlink,
into a little bit more context, if you would.
Well, basically what it was is a particular company applied for a registration for a new technology. And at that time, EPA, I believe, or FDA, one of those two agencies, approved for the first time a split registration for that acceptance of that technology. One was for feed use and one was for food use. We'd never done that. And I think the valuable lesson that came out of that whole consternation is that is something I don't think will ever happen again. I think we need to make sure we've got all the hurdles addressed before we release that type of technology into the marketplace, because we are in a global marketplace today, and it's got to have not only the acceptance of consumers in this country, it's got to have the acceptance of consumers in Europe and Asia. And one of the valuable lessons we've learned through this whole transformation of technology is you've got to have that line of communication open. Europe has been much more resistant, i.e. Greenpeace, of keeping technology out of their country, because they have this false sense of hope that there is not going to be the type of regulatory scrutiny in releasing some of this new technology in the marketplace. Mm-hmm.
I recall, I don't think it was too long ago, there was a real challenge because there was genetically altered grain that got mixed indiscriminately with grain that wasn't genetically altered, and then you got into the issue of the foreign markets and how it could be marketed.
That was part of the Starlink episode, okay. Yes.
Is Asia also resistant to some of that?
They're actually, what we've tried to do, and this is where it goes back to that first biotechnology advisory committee that I was a part of. What we have said as a country, and we've tried to get a protocol that all countries would buy into, so you've got the same type of assurances that meet the certain scrutiny of the various countries that are trading partners with us, as well as their technology. So we've tried to get trying to get everybody to buy into a protocol that would level out that standardization of that technology coming into the marketplace. Unfortunately, that doesn't necessarily hold the political weight back in various countries, i.e. when we got into the mad cow incident in Canada and the borders were closed. The same thing happened in Great Britain as it related to mad cow disease. We've seen a little bit of that on the technology and the grain side. So, you know, as you develop this whole global trading our global economy that we're a part of, you run into these issues, and hopefully we're going to be smarter as we go forward in trying to address them.
What's the vehicle, or what are the institutions that attempt to get agreements, standardization across the international boundaries?
Well, the big vehicle that's in place, but unfortunately not all countries are a part of it, is the World Trading Organization, or WTO. The general agreements of tariffs and trade before the WTO. The fallacy of that is that if all the trading countries are not a part of that, Russia is not, as we speak, you play by two different sets of rules.
And they play the advantages to their benefits, I'm sure.
And they do. And matter of fact, I happen to be on the AFBF Trade Advisory Committee, and we were just in Geneva, Switzerland, back in September, the week that we had the meltdown in the financial community. And one of the major talking points that week, not only trying to get the WTO talks concluded, was the accession of Russia into the WTO. And what has happened there with the political ramifications this last year has really held up them becoming a member of the World Trading Organization.
From what you said, I'm taking it, it's Russia's leadership, political leadership, that's dragging their feet?
No, just the opposite. The World Trading Organizations, you've got about 137 countries that are a part of the WTO. They would like to come in, but some of the major players in the World Trading Organization, given what happened in Russia, as it related to some of the things politically that happened, have really kind of drug their feet of allowing Russia in.
Chechnya, I'm trying to think of the other flashpoints in the old Soviet Union now that are playing out. So it was those kinds of things.
Yes.
Okay.
It's a whole different thought process. But going back to your question, you know, what is the standardization to accept this? The World Trade Organization is the best template. But now, since that hasn't happened, you've got the Organization of International Guidelines, or the OIE report that Japan looks at, and then you've got Canada that has a different set. So we have really a patchwork quilt of various, you know, trading regulations and, you know, restrictions.
AFBF. What's the acronym stand for?
The American Farm Bureau Federation.
Okay. And how is that distinct from Illinois Farm Bureau, from the American Farm Bureau?
Well, the American Farm Bureau is the umbrella for all the state farm bureaus to be a part of. We have all 50 states plus Puerto Rico that are a member of that organization. They have about 6.2 million members nationwide. Illinois happens to be the fifth largest Farm Bureau state in that federation. We have 420,000 members in Illinois, and that is a compilation of farmer members plus associate members.
And AFBF, the affiliation there?
They have 6.2 million members, and they don't diversify their classification. It's all membership.
Is that a different organization with an incredible amount of overlap?
Well, it's the national organization that basically represents us in Washington, D.C., at the World Trade Talks on the international scene.
Okay. It's the F that threw me off there, then.
Yes, it is a federation.
Okay.
And Illinois Farm Bureau is one of the major players in that organization. Okay. We'd like to think we're the premier farm organization of the American Farm Bureau.
Well, you're always in competition with my home state of Iowa in terms of peak production levels, for grain at least, for soybean and corn. I'm sure that some other Midwest states are in the top tier as well.
Actually, we are the largest Midwest state by far in membership. We just came back from our annual meeting and really received all the president awards by the American in our membership category.
Okay.
So, but no, we're by far the largest in the Midwest. There really isn't anybody too close to us.
Let's talk about how you've already told us that you're still in the animal side of agriculture as well. How has that changed in the time frame you've been involved?
Well, it has transformed probably every bit as much as the crop side. I can remember as a kid growing up on the farm where we raised our hogs outside on dirt with electric fences, and on a Sunday afternoon, we would try to corral those hogs to take them to the marketplace, and you'd start with a 20-acre field with panels to get them into a corner to be able to load them. And at that time, you know, the hogs were raised outside. They fought the elements of weather and sun and the snow in the wintertime, and did not have heated buildings, and we had high death losses given the inclement weather that we faced. Take that from where I was as a kid growing up to where we are today, where our livestock, for the most part, are in controlled environments indoors. This morning as we talk, we had minus 42 degrees with wind chill, and I walked into our barns that were 65 to 70 degrees heated. The hogs and the cattle had all the comforts of almost a person living in a house as you know it, just because of the way we've improved the efficiency, but we've improved the control of the environment as opposed to 30 years ago. Also in that same time period, we've improved the genetics of the animals that we raise. I can remember growing up on the farm in early years where it would take 7 to 8 months to finish a hog to 240 pounds. Today, we do that in 4.5 months, and they reach 260 pounds. So the genetics that we have bred into, particularly the hogs, have really made things much more efficient in the utilization of the corn or the feedstuffs that go into that animal. On the flip side, on the dairy side, if you look at the pounds of milk per cow, when we were growing up, that number was 16 or 17,000 pounds in my early days. Now that number is 23, 24,000 pounds per cow. So you look at, really, technology has had a dramatic impact, as well as genetics, in the livestock side of the equation as well.
Part of it, we've already talked about the tendency towards larger operations and more efficient operations as you get into economy of scales. Is the same thing going on the animal side?
Yes, I think that we are probably, you know, more so on the animal side than the grain side, because we have found out as we have grown the operations, I think we've become more specialized. And in the case of our farming operation, it's very true. We used to do everything from the breeding of the hog to the farrowing of the hog to the weaning and finishing of that market pig. Today, we, meaning our farming operation, we contract with a guy who does nothing more than the breeding and the farrowing and the weaning, and then bring those pigs to our particular farm, and we finish them only. So I think you become more specialized, but the numbers are growing. And part of the reason for that is when you look at the number of sows that a person can manage versus where we used to do it all outside, where it took a lot more people to manage those sows and those hog herds or beef herds or dairy herds, you can do that much more efficiently under a roof where you might have multiple barns to walk through. That I think the care for those animals have improved immensely, that you can really manage more.
How many hogs was your dad finishing 40 years ago?
Probably somewhere in the area of 500.
Per year?
Yes. And today we're at about 5,000.
Okay. So there's a good example of that trend.
Yes.
And are you on the large end of that?
No, I'd say we're probably on the smaller side of that. There's operations that have 10, 20,000 that they finish. You know, we're probably on the shorter side of that. And I think part of that is due to the fact we're fairly diversified. A lot of pork producers today are so specialized that they buy a lot of their inputs, their corn. They've become so large that they rely on the corn farmers in a particular area to furnish their inputs as it relates to corn or soybeans.
How close were you to getting out of the pork business a few years ago when the market collapsed?
In 1998, it was a challenge because we had hog prices in the single digits, 8 cents a pound, which meant at that time we were getting about $25 for a finished hog. And it really flushed out a number of pork producers in our particular area. But no, we've stayed through it through thick and thin. We were farrowing at that time. And then coming into the Farm Bureau, where I don't have quite the hands-on involvement that I'd like to have in a particular livestock operation, I rely on our help to do that. We got out of the farrowing to try to streamline that process.
What was going on in 1998 that caused that collapse in prices?
Two things really happened. It was a overproduction. You talk about producing. We had an overproduction of pork in this country, and really the export markets collapsed. So both of those issues hit at the same time, which really caused the pork market to go into a free fall. And there was overproduction not only domestically but internationally, coming out of Canada and Denmark. Two major hog-producing areas basically contributed to that as well.
Was there an expectation that the hog market internationally was going to grow, and it did the opposite then?
Well, as you see population grow worldwide, one of the first things that a developing country does is acquire more meat or protein in their diets. And along with that, we had a glut of protein. It wasn't just pork, poultry added into that as well. So it was the protein market that really tanked worldwide, and we suffered the consequences of that. The other thing that happened in that demise in 1998 was our shackle space, or the amount of space where hogs were processed, was very tight at the time. And for the first time, we had an overproduction of animals, and we had a shortage of slots to process the particular animals. So everything, it was the perfect storm, so to speak, where all of these factors came together, and it just went into a free fall in the commodity price.
Well, recently the United States government has gotten into the business of bailing out certain industries, or certain, banking and automobile. I don't recall that there was any talk about bailing out hog farmers back then.
No. And you know, the livestock industry, for the most part, has been a pretty strong industry over time. They've never participated in any government program, any government buyout that you've just alluded to. They've been pretty much free thinkers, and they've taken it upon themselves to dictate when they cut back or do things to try to make prices respond. They're very independent. And I think that continues. The cow-calf producer is very independent, as well as the pork producer, whether it's the person that farrows the wean or the person that finishes the hogs.
Do you see the same kind of consolidation going on in the beef industry as we have in the pork industry over the last 20 years?
Well, I don't think you're going to see quite the acceleration that we have seen in pork or poultry, where we have integrated. To a degree, the poultry industry is almost totally integrated. And by that, I mean that the processor really controls everything to the start of the process through contracting. Pork, through the collapse of the 1998 demise in the free fall of the prices, I think integrated more. We now only have about 15% of all the hogs that are bought on a spot market. That means that they're not contracted. So that particular industry has integrated substantially since 1998. I don't think you're going to see the beef industry go through quite that consolidation or integration for a couple reasons. Number one, it's hard to integrate that cow-calf producer all the way to the feedlot, because that cowboy, wherever he or she may be, whether it's in Illinois or out west, it takes a long time. By the time you breed the cow, you calve that cow, and that calf hits the feedlot. And I don't see that coming to a degree of integration like we saw the other species, because how quickly you can turn around that bird or that hog from conception to the time that it hits the grocery store.
For Illinois, for example, does that play out so that there's a lot more Illinois farmers who have a fairly small number of cattle that they're finishing off than there are for hogs?
Well, we probably are not near as big as a Wyoming or Montana or Virginia as it relates to cow-calf production. But having said that, one of our priority issues in our organization over the last 3 years is trying to grow the animal agriculture industry in this state for a couple reasons. Number one, we need to have the cow-calf producer expand so that we can feed more cattle in Illinois. Either that or we import them in. And given the whole change as it relates to the food and fuel debate, we've built a lot of ethanol plants in Illinois over the last couple of years. And there's an awful lot of co-products that come out of those plants that are very advantageous to that feedlot operator or pork producer. So we're trying to address that as we grow that industry as well. So hopefully at the end of the day, we have a vibrant animal livestock industry here in Illinois.
There has been a lot of resistance from the general public, though, to some of these larger animal operations, especially the pork operations. Can you address that?
Well, actually, we've had our hands full in trying to grow the livestock industry in Illinois as it relates to siting issues. We've been very fortunate in this state My forefathers or predecessors put a Livestock Management Facilities Act in place here in Illinois that says that if you're going to grow your livestock operation, you need to meet the following criteria. Setbacks are a part of that. Nutrient management plans are a part of that. Certainly the specs on the building and the foundation, the pit structure or lagoon, as it relates to their manure handling facilities are a part of that. Having said that, the biggest rub and disconnect that we have seen over the last decade is as we've tried to expand our livestock operations, and a lot of those are family-run operations, the person that moved out from the city to the rural area does not really understand those particular hoops that producer has to jump through to make that happen. And at the same time, there's a real disconnect between agriculture and that rural type of living or neighborhoods that we've really had to try to address. Out of that has come where we've had informational meetings to try to explain to them what will be happening in those particular operations, whether it's a dairy farm or a pork facility or a cattle feedlot. So I think we've tried to act more responsively in the last couple of years in trying to site these facilities and make sure everybody understands what is coming and what is to be expected.
I'm going to do a poor job of asking this question, but I recall talking to somebody else that part of this dynamic and being able to approve what is essentially zoning decisions is driven by just the way that the zoning decisions are done. And I'm talking about the nature of government and the scale of government, whether these are countywide decisions that have to be made or community-wide decisions, and whether it's easy or difficult to get some of these things approved. Can you talk about that?
Well, the siting and the regulatory framework is done at the state level, not at the county level. The county can recommend. There's a non-binding informational meeting that is held. County zoning boards can vote no, but the state statute basically prevails and the siting is done at the state level. And that's important because if it were to be done on a county-by-county basis, we'd have a whole patchwork set of regulations across this state. And that was done by design to say, you know, there's a role for the state to play in here that makes sure that everybody's got the same level of regulations from deep southern Illinois to northwestern Illinois. And it's worked. And most other states in this country follow that same type of methodology. At the same time, I think the one thing that we do have in the Livestock Management Facilities Act is to have local input into the process, and that's what that informational meeting is held for. That input goes into the Illinois Department of Agriculture as they try to gather the information to either decide to allow the operation to go forward in site or not.
Are you, at this point in time, are you generally satisfied that that balance is working for Illinois?
Well, I think the only caveat that I'd say to that is sometimes I get a little frustrated when the emotion trump card gets played over science and what the particular operator has done to try to meet all the criteria that's mm-hmm. been asked for. And that has happened a couple times here as of late. And that does bother me because, you know, it appears the outside influence, not the people that live in the local area where this operation is being sited. And you know, that's happened here lately more so than I care to admit to. I think the concern that I have is let the local people who live there, reside there, let them express their concerns if there are any, not the people that live outside of the area that pile on to say we don't want animal agriculture at all. And I think the concern even gets greater. Proposition 2 in California that passed 63% to 27%, 28% somewhere there, 37%. But anyway, when that passed, that told me that emotion rules at the end of the day.
Tell us more about Proposition 2.
Proposition 2 did really three things. It expanded the size of cages for laying hens in poultry production. It's probably going to cost consumers in California almost 50% more for their egg production if there's going to be any egg production left in California. It got rid of gestating crates for sows for housing purposes through the gestating time period and eliminated veal production in California because of the crate characterization that the Humane Society of the United States put forward. The reason I say that that was an important proposition that passed by 60-some percent of the voting public is it said to me that I guess they're not that concerned of where their food comes from. As a producer and as a consumer, I am concerned where my food comes from, that it is safe and that it's went through a regulatory framework before it ends up in my refrigerator or on our dining room table at night.
Well, could they say that they are more concerned because they want these changes implemented? Are they going to be importing from other states more of these products because they're not going to be producing them in California?
I think they will be importing more of those because from a production standpoint, I think some of the producers that I've talked to in California will be forced out of production just because of the standards that they've put up. There needs to be a balance, and I think this is an important point, between what consumers want and what producers can produce. And somehow we have flipped this equation around to the point that they don't understand the production practices that take place in modern-day production agriculture today. And it's a big concern because I don't think it stops with animals or livestock production. It might even go to dust being emitted off of farming operations. And somehow we've got to do a better job of telling that story about what's happening in production agriculture today to the consumer. I think we do that in a number of ways through Illinois Farm Bureau. Our Ag in the Classroom program is a small step in that direction. We also do it in a couple of the publications that we produce right here in-house in Illinois Farm Bureau, our Partners Magazine and our Farm Week publication.
We're going to have more opportunity when we get into the Farm Bureau aspect of this interview later on to talk about those. Ethanol production, how has that changed the nature of your personal business and Illinois farmers in general?
We'll go back to 30 years ago when I got involved farming. We used to call it gasohol, and big oil really trashed that particular commodity, saying it had no future. And what really transformed over the last 30 years is, I think, a number of things. There used to be an additive called MTBE that big oil produced as a fuel additive to help hopefully improve the octane of the gasoline that consumers were buying. At the same time that was being produced, we went from gasohol to ethanol. And we found out that it not only improved octane in a particular consumer's gasoline, but it was good for the environment. At the same time, MTBE got down into groundwater and contaminated a number of water reservoirs, and thus EPA eliminated MTBE. That really catapulted homegrown fuels or ethanol or biodiesel into the spotlight. I think along the way, about 4 years ago when we had our first energy bill that contained a particular a goal and objective of trying to get to a certain plateau, at that time 7.5 billion gallons of ethanol as a part of the overall energy portfolio, that sent the signal that we're going to grow this, and we're going to grow it primarily in the Midwest from corn production. President Bush gave it another shot in the arm as he put a 30 billion gallon renewable fuel standard, of which ethanol based or corn based ethanol would contribute about 15 billion of that. The other 15 billion was going to come from cellulose based ethanol. So really, we've had quite a turnaround in the whole ethanol or biofuels industry, and it's really come back to farmers. And most of that push originated right here in Illinois. Ironically, in its early days, it was Illinois farmers that were saying, this is good for the environment, let's have a long-term energy plan. We think we can produce that particular fuel to the magnitude that we will have an impact on it. This last year, in 2008, we bumped over the 5 billion gallon mark. At the end of 2009, we'll probably be at 7.5 billion gallons of ethanol. And we think that we've got, given the technology that we're seeing in corn production, we think we've got the ability to grow most of that production right here in the Midwest to satisfy the needs of the U.S. consumer.
There has been criticism lately, though, that the amount of fuel inputs versus the amount of fuel outputs isn't necessarily all that advantageous. Do you know what the ratio is for 1 gallon of ethanol? How much fuel has gone into that before that point?
Well, the efficiency of that has always been knocked by a number of the big oil participants saying it doesn't have near the efficiency that regular gasoline has, or that we could maybe even make another product that doesn't utilize quite the resources that corn-based ethanol does. But that efficiency has gotten better over time. We've also heard the knock that we use too many gallons of water to produce a gallon of ethanol. But contrast that, and I'll use the water example as a good example. It takes 9 gallons of water to produce a gallon of gasoline. It only takes 3 gallons of water to produce a gallon of ethanol. I think the one thing that's important to take away from this is efficiencies are getting better and better as time marches on. Research is being done at SIU at Edwardsville that looks at this and trying to improve the process. And I think that one thing that is quite clear, over time, I think we do have to have a blend of both corn-based ethanol and maybe cellulose-based ethanol. But as I sit here today, in early 2009, we're still probably 5 years away from making that cellulose-based ethanol
the switchgrass, for example?
Switchgrass, timber, almost any product can be used in the cellulose-based component.
Well, I'm probably going to be sloppy on the percentages here, but I was thinking that right now, the numbers I've been hearing is that for 1 gallon of fuel inputs, you're getting about a gallon and a third out of at the end of ethanol production. Does that sound about right?
I'm going to have to look at that because those numbers are changing and it's a moving target. Mm-hmm. The one thing that I constantly hear is that it's not efficient and that we should be able to move something down the path quicker than we can with corn-based ethanol. I will tell you, as it relates to biodiesel, you do get more BTUs out of a gallon of biodiesel than you do ethanol. But having said that, I think the processes are very different as well.
In the biodiesel case, we're primarily talking about soybeans?
Right.
Okay. I've also heard that, for example, taking sugarcane and converting that to ethanol is much more efficient than taking corn, for example, just because of the sugar content you're talking about.
Not necessarily true. You know, it'll cost you about a buck and a half a gallon to make a gallon of ethanol right now as we speak. One of the reasons that everybody says sugar is much more efficient in making ethanol, and you use that in South America, part of that is being driven by a sugar program, much more so than corn-based ethanol. Because we looked at this a couple years ago when there was a glut of sugar. Sugar producers were going out of business, especially in the Red River Valley and down in Louisiana. But if you were to look at the world price of sugar, you probably could be more efficient if we took away our sugar program in this country and went towards a sugar-based ethanol. But you don't get quite the BTU content out of sugar as you do corn-based ethanol.
And I know that is one of the other issues. The oil industry will tell you there's a lot higher BTU out of their product than the ethanol as well. Can you address that criticism?
Well, you're dealing with more of a pure product, and that's one of the reasons that they can make that statement. But it doesn't boost the octane like you can with a with a 10% or 15% blend of ethanol. And that's one thing that I think we're going to have to work on going forward is, you know, at what point can we push our engines in this country to not only be efficient, but at the same time allow that conservation to take place that probably needs to get there. And we think that we can move that 10% blend of ethanol up to maybe 15% and make that happen without altering anything.
Well, let's place this thing into context for those people down the road sometime are going to be listening to this tape or watching the video here. What were corn and soybean prices in June and July of 2008?
In 2008, we were approaching $7 to $8
for
a bushel for corn.
And soybeans?
We were in the $15 range.
What is it today?
Today, corn is selling for about $3.20 a bushel, and soybeans are about $9.50.
This is all prefaced as saying or asking you this question. What do you say to those people who are very critical about ethanol production because it drove up the price of corn and therefore it drove up the price of food in most of the world?
Well, I say that it's not as linked as what they would like to have seen, because with the grocers manufacturers had a huge campaign to point all the fingers at ethanol. And the only thing I'll say is if you walked into your grocery store today and looked at the price of a box of cornflakes or cereal, that that price has not come down correspondingly when we've seen a 50 and 60% decline in commodity prices. One thing that I think really led to the run-up of prices back in July of 2008 was energy. I mean, we were looking at $150 a barrel crude oil, which some were saying was going to go to 200, if you recall.
Yep.
And now that has come down to a low of about $37 a barrel. We saw gasoline prices in excess of $4 a gallon. Just recently here in December, we had gas down to $1.50 a gallon. So I don't think you can really blame it all on ethanol. Matter of fact, a small portion of that goes into the actual consumer price increases that we have seen. I think you can blame a lot of it on the energy, and you can blame a lot on the speculation that drove this market to those really high levels that probably we should not have seen. And when you look at index funds that drove that, not only on the commodity side, they drove it on the energy side as well.
I want to, later on in the interview, we want to go back to the issue of the Illinois Farm Bureau and relationship with the Chicago Board of Trade and the whole discussion about speculation at that time. So let's shift gears here a little bit and ask you about the impact of GPS, computer technology, some of these other things that maybe 30 years ago you couldn't even imagine, the impact that that's had on agriculture.
Well, 30 years ago we didn't farm by the square inch like we do now. And by that I mean we use global positioning to spread our fertilizer, take our soil tests, of which we do to, really you might say we almost farm by prescription farming today. When we see a 2-acre grid in a soil sample that calls for 5 ton of lime, we just spread that 2-acre grid at 5 ton, and maybe 2/3 of the rest of the field doesn't get anything. So we not only farm by the square inch, we plant by the square inch from the standpoint that now we can control in our planter today. We can go across the field and use variable rate planting, where the good ground might get 35,000-36,000 plants per acre. The lighter soils might drop to 28,000, all in the same 8 rows going across a half a mile field. It's phenomenal, but even more importantly than that, we now have yield monitors and precision farming in our combines. When we harvest, we know what a particular hybrid is yielding as we go across that 8 rows when we're combining in the fall. And that helps us better prepare for the following year as we not only select the hybrids that we plant, but apply the fertilizers to the particular field as well.
all of that technology comes with a price, does it not?
It does. And depending on at what stage you are, and I think we've got farmers in this state that are at various stages of probably not utilizing any of it or a small amount of it, to the farmers that have auto steer technology that basically utilizes a satellite to keep a farmer on row, whether spraying, cultivating, harvesting, where the farmer doesn't even turn the steering wheel anymore. I mean, it's really high-tech farming at its best.
Is that what one of the things that's driving towards consolidation or larger farm operations?
I don't think that is as much as the efficiency. Take, for example, in our farming operation, we have auto shutoffs on our spray rig, so we don't overlap spraying, which means it doesn't cost you as much as it relates to chemicals. You don't overspray, so there's less chemical that is applied. But even more responsibly, that you're only putting what needs to be put out there. I think the one thing it does do is it adds to less fatigue by the operator. Some of us put 16, 18-hour days in when we're combining or planting, and if you're not there having to hold that steering wheel or look at a particular monitor all the time with such precision, it makes life a little bit more enjoyable in that combine cab or a tractor cab when you're putting those type of hours in.
Often wonder what farmers are listening to when they're in the cab.
Well, they listen to a radio. We multitask. Not only do you listen to a radio, you got to keep your eye on that screen as to what you're doing. But, you know, I think most farmers listen to country western music as they're going up and down the rows, and something to try to keep the monotony when you start putting long hours in during the course of a day.
Mm-hmm. But now you can have a 70 or 80-year-old farmer out there plowing for 8, 10, 12 hours. And I would imagine back 40 or 50 years ago, that was quite a strain.
Well, I use the example of our farming operation 30 years ago. You know, not all our tractors even had cabs on them. The safety features that are equipped today are much better than they were when I started farming. And I've got a 9-year-old son who runs a number of our pieces of equipment, and I don't have to worry near about the safety issues that I would have if I were starting him 30 years ago. But having said that, you know, the comfort factor is much better. You're not inhaling dust. You can see at the end of the day where some of us, when we got started, were on non-cab tractors and dust was flying every which way, and you got in at the end of the day to wash your eyes out just to be able to see or breathe.
Not to mention the health hazard that presented.
That's what I mean. It's much better working conditions today than it was when I first started farming.
The other thing that seems to have a huge impact in terms of the productivity are fertilizers and how they're applied, herbicides and pesticides. How has that changed during the time you've been farming?
Well, we don't use near as much, as I said before. You know, and the chemicals are much more effective. You know, the Roundup herbicide really changed the way we farm, both corn and soybeans. I can remember 30 years ago, when we started no-tilling soybeans, the biggest problem we had was controlling weeds. And the joke was, in the neighborhood, you could tell so-and-so was no-tilling because they had the dirtiest looking soybean fields around. And it showed when you combined, you had more foreign material and weed content in that sample. Having said so, when Roundup came out and you started planting Roundup Ready soybeans, all of a sudden the weed pressure was eliminated. It was such a good chemical. It was safe to apply. Farmers accepted that type of technology quickly, and thus, you know, we cleaned up a lot of our soybean fields. And the same happened with corn when we got into some of that same technology in the corn fields.
What does it mean to be a Roundup Ready soybean?
Well, it's basically the technology that is bred into that soybean seed that allows a plant to grow, put a particular chemical on that plant that does not really set the plant back when certain herbicides would set the plant back, and it kills off basically anything but the plant out there on weeds.
Has that improved in terms of the environmental impact of applying, again, all three, herbicides, pesticides, and the fertilizer?
Oh, very much so. I think the other thing that it has done is basically brought up the yields, because, you know, a plant competes with a weed for sunlight, for moisture content, and if you can eliminate that at a particular time as that plant is growing, it allows that plant to produce more. So really, it's done a number of things, but I think, you know, not only the Roundup aspect of chemical production, if you look at the traits that we are breeding into these plants today, and on the soybean side, whether it's for higher protein or higher oil content, depending on what that particular end use is being used for, or if you look at the corn borer resistant, the rootworm resistant variety traits that are bred into corn production, has had a tremendous impact on not having to apply pesticides during the growing season. It's all in that particular germplasm.
So it means a lot less runoff of these things into the water supply, for
very
example.
Much so.
We've got just a few more questions here, and before we have to finish up for today, what of all these changes that you've seen in agriculture yourself do you think have had the biggest impact?
Well, I would say probably, you know, from the standpoint of technology and crop production, the chemicals or the lack of chemicals that we have to use today has had a significant impact on the bottom line and the production of particular row crop production. I think also, as we've looked at the technology on the livestock side, bringing animals inside and controlling their environment and keeping them in a much more comfortable environment has had a significant impact on the production side of livestock producers. Mm-hmm. But certainly over the last two decades, we have witnessed, you know, huge strides, I think, in a very positive direction for all of agriculture as a result of some of these technologies that we've seen.
But a lot of the technologies that we've talked about here definitely have a high input cost to it. So can you talk about input costs versus profits and that challenge that you've got?
Well, we cited 2008 as a roller coaster ride on commodity prices. We saw the same thing on input costs. In 2008, we doubled the price of fertilizer. We doubled almost the price of diesel fuel that farmers were using. We saw almost a 60% increase in prices as it related to seed corn, seed beans from last year, let alone cash rent rates have almost doubled in price. So with that, a farmer's bottom line, even though you might have seen some of these exorbitant prices, based on what the commodity prices were doing, but yet their margin of profit just got squeezed huge in 2008 and going into 2009. So with that, we're going to have to see some, escalation of prices back to higher levels than where we're at right now, because in some cases, farmers are below the cost of production or producing a particular commodity, whether that be corn or soybeans.
Or to see the input costs drop.
And I don't think you're going to see the input prices come down quickly because of the pipeline of input supplies is fairly great, and that's everything from fertilizer to seed. So I think there's at least going to be a year lag before you start to see that pendulum come back the other way.
Okay. The last two questions I've got for today are a little different track here, if you will. Talk about the relationship between you and your wife are both active on the farm, and how are those roles changing over time?
Well, I think they have changed a lot. I look at my mom and my wife's mom that were more stay-at-home moms. They picked up the slack in the farming operation. But I think today, those individuals, like my wife, have become more business-oriented. I mean, she not only does the books, she helps selling of the crops. She manages the farming operation in my absence. And at the same time, she's the one responsible that seems to have to make decisions on an as-needed basis. I think you're seeing more of that professionalism come through the family, where the spouses are taking a more active role in the business side of the farming operation. And it is a business. It's a big business today compared to 30 or 40 years ago. And that's not to diminish what roles my mom and dad had. But you're dealing with high dollar agriculture today. You know, this last year, we had to double the amount of money that was required just to put an operating loan together because of the rise in input costs. The operations have gotten bigger. You've got to pay more attention to your break-even costs and your bottom lines today, or you won't stay in business. That's the part that I see the spouse has really stepped up to a different level to be a part of that decision-making process.
What's the role of higher education then in preparing both husband and wife for that?
Oh, I think it's almost a given that you've got to go beyond the high school diploma, whether it's junior college or whether it's a specialty course or courses that you take. I always said when I was in high school, I wanted to be an accountant by trade for a couple reasons. I was always a numbers guy. You needed to know what your break-even costs were. I was probably one of the early innovators in a computer in our farming operation back in the 70s. I had a computer that did all of our book work, and that's evolved. But my kids laugh when they see what type of computer we had back in the 70s to what they do today. And I look at our daughter and our son, they can maneuver through a computer better than I'll ever be able to. And at their age in life, that's just going to be a norm for them as it relates to trying to put the technologies that we have in the combine cab or the tractor cab into that laptop as you prescribe what type of nutrients or seed that you want to apply to a particular acre in your farming operation.
Last question for today then, Philip, and this requires you to put your modesty to the side for a little bit. I know that in 1991 you were named Outstanding Farmer. Tell us a little bit more about that, and especially why it was you that the United States, that it was it the Illinois Farm or the American Farm Bureau that made that decision?
Actually, I don't know. There's two different times.
Okay. I was
actually named as the Star Farmer through the FFA, and then I was also named one of the National Outstanding Young Farmers by the American Farm Bureau. But then a few years later, the JCs of the United States picked me as the Outstanding Young Farmer. So I don't know which one you're alluding to.
Well, I saw the picture up here, the letter from George Bush in 1991.
Yes, that was the JCs.
Okay.
And I think that was really a compilation of a number of things. It's based on your community involvement. It's based on growing your farming operation. I was somewhat unique because I think I was the first single person. I was not married at the time. I had not even met Carmen hardly at that time. It was shortly thereafter. So, and it was based on an interview. And I think it was a number of the things that I was involved in. And I think the highlight was going to the Oval Office and meeting with the President of the United States and his wife, Barbara, at that time, and talking about the future of agriculture. And I was impressed, to say the least.
I'm smiling because I'm thinking about Garrison Keillor and talking about that bachelor farmers, the Norwegian bachelor farmers that he always loves to talk about.
Well, it was a remarkable honor because I was nominated by our local JCs. And I won the state competition. And the ironic thing was about it, the state competition was held in Moline, Illinois. And my dad had a farming accident and was in the hospital, so my mom went to the state contest, and I won. And she was there, and ironically, that fall, at age 57, she had a massive heart attack and died. And the national competition was held in the same hotel as the state in Moline, Illinois. And my dad was out of the hospital and went to see me win the national award.
I bet that meant the world to them.
And it did. And I view part of that is the drive that they instilled in us as kids. And you always try to do something to please your mom and dad. And that certainly was a high point in both of their minds as I won the state and the national competition.
Well, we've got something like 2 hours of interviewing already. And it's fascinating to listen to you talk about these things. And it's obvious that you've had opportunities to talk about a lot of these issues we've addressed today throughout the entire state and country and maybe even beyond that point. So I look forward to hearing the next time we sit down and talk more about the Illinois Farm Bureau, your involvement, that organization. So thank you very much, Philip.
Thank you.